committee staff. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Audit and Risk Management Committee. This first one for 2015. Item 1, code of conduct and declarations of interest. Are we having? Item 2, minutes of last meeting. Everyone agreed?
Agreed.
Item 3, continue order for basis of department.
Chair, this is a regular report that I present to members of this committee. Contains information related to the delivery of the internal audit service. This particular report covers a period from the 1st November through to the 31st of December 2014. The report concentrates on the identification of any items of note or places that I feel where the escalation from the monthly reports have received. Provides information related to the performance of the internal audit service and identifies the developments that will take place to improve when we deliver the service. Your attention is specifically drawn within this report to section 2.2, where a number of items of note are identified. The 2.2a I refer to credits and payments. Members should note that the key recommendations agreed with management to address issues identified during the National Fraud Initiative exercise now being implemented, including actions taken to recover a small number of duplicate payments that have been identified and were discussed at the November meeting of this committee in May. Excuse me. At 2.2b, interim order requested by the Strategic Director for Transformation Resources to undertake a review of the payments that have been made to a service provider before examining the actual commissioning expenditure in compliance with the Council's operating rules. Audit work identified that elements of the Council's conduct procedure rules have not been fully complied with, and a report was prepared for senior management that identified 11 recommendations in total, of which 4 of those were the high risk nature and have been actioned immediately. The Strategic Director for Transformation Process, Joe Bart, is with us and will be sort of presenting on this shortly. I continue with my sort of summarization of the problem from that item. At 2.2c, I identify the work that we've undertaken at schools and in the internal audit staff a number of rural schools in order to their financial governance procedures and arrangements. Schools are selected following a detailed risk assessment which considers a number of criteria. The 2014 programme schools have now to be completed. I think it's worthy of noting that that has been the case. Issues identified by schools selected like that are sort of farmed out to all of the sort of rural schools on them, so they can learn from issues that are identified in specific areas. At 2.2d, I refer your attention to the work that we've undertaken on the ICT business continuity and disaster recovery programme. Internal audit recently followed up the recommendations arising from the audit of ICT business continuity to determine whether the Council has documented its policy and approach to ICT business continuity planning, has put in place appropriate management arrangements for the governance and reporting of continuity, and what actions to be taken in the event of the loss of ICT services. The findings identify the progress has been made in this area, and there is a health, safety and resilience programme underway to improve overall business continuity, including ICT. Part of this programme, the senior leadership team, formerly CSG, have agreed a list of critical activities associated with identified work programmes to ensure that these services have suitable plans and arrangements in place. More work is planned over the next couple of months to address all of the issues identified, and I'll continue to keep you sort of updated with regards to what progress has been made. What I will also say there is this was identified as a fairly significant issue in the annual governance statement of last year, so it is something that's worthy of your attention. It is something that we need to sort of monitor and make sure that things are progressing in the right way. I would also like to add there that the corporate governance group are responsible for overseeing the items identified in the previous government statements and are paying particular close attention to this particular item to ensure that we can sort of avoid a repetition of inclusion in the issue statement. Can I also draw your attention to section 2.2 of the report where the table identifies information relating to those orders where recommended actions included in your report, so not currently being implemented as identified. All of the recommendations in the attached appendix 1 are probably both in Lambert and identifying that progress is being made within we've laid down timescales. Again, I'll sort of point out to you that, recommendations, the fact that I'm standing where I am is predominantly because they sort of sit within the timescales that we've agreed and the follow sort of timescales that, we sort of identify for repeat visits to the areas that we review. Section 2.4, I report identify information that's specific to the performance of the internal audit service. And you will note that at this moment in time, the service is approximately on target to deliver the internal audit plan. Comfortable with the position that we're in at this precise moment in time. Feedback from clients, management proceedings remains good, with all key actions identified with reports being completed. And the client satisfaction levels remain consistently high. Section 2.5 of the report identifies some of the continuing improvements that have been made to improving the internal audit service. You'll be aware that we have a sort of improvement action plan in place that we're constantly sort of revisiting. There are a lot of issues arising out of the new public sector internal audit standards, like that, which we're having to sort of take account of and reported to you previously on. So we'll be sort of adding to that, sort of continuing rolling sort of development on that. That's probably as much as I need to say in terms of summarising the report, but I'm more than happy to take any questions that members might have.
Thanks a lot. Have you got any questions?
Maybe just short ones. Thank you very much for the report. On page 11, it says on the internal audit performance indicator, percentage of high priority recommendations can be with clients. I just wondered who the clients were. And if I just get the other question out of the way as well, our schools audit, is that sort of statutory requirement? I don't know, so I just wondered, is that the
Response to the school
audit,
yes, it is. Percentage of high project recommendations to do with clients. The clients are effectively sort of the auditees, the managers from across the organisation that are responsible for receiving internal reports and managing individual systems and certain areas. They refer to this client because it's sort of it's a catch-all phrase really of identifying sort of managing the senior managers.
Thank you.
Sure.
I don't know
whether
you hand over to Joe, but to talk to the commission on this, and there's a fairly big issue there. I can see but whether I want to ask questions on it now before I've read.
What was your question there?
So, yes, I was going to ask page 5 of the internal audit and the recommendations. It goes to the
board of
housing.
It
just says. If you go to the affordable housing programme, it just says that reasonable assurances were provided on the current progress of the programme framework. What are reasonable assurances and why hasn't it followed the criteria of this information sheet? I notice where there are sort of blanks in other areas, there are reviews taking place, something's actually going on, whereas in this, it's just reasonable assurances. What's that mean?
This wasn't a specific internal audit. It was a piece of work that we were asked to sort of come and provide an opinion on. So we didn't approach it the same way we would have on a normal structured audit, where there's a sort of attempt and a cadence agreement whereby we'll provide opinions at the end of that. There's a lot of work that we're going to take during the course of the sort of year, and that there hasn't been a pre-programme that's included within. But we feel we're adding value by sort of providing advice and guidance to some managers in relation to specific areas of sensitivity in that. Because this is a report of all the work that some internal audits have undertaken, and the outcome of this particular piece of work was that we made some, whilst they're not formal recommendations, we made some sort of, we identified some sort of areas for development and improvement there. So it was appropriate to include within this report, because it just brings to your attention the fact that there are things that we're undertaking above and beyond normal, and it allows you to sort of keep an eye on if that remains on this report for any longer than the agreed time scale that we've identified there. You should be asking questions as to why it remains there when we've identified areas for improvement that haven't been addressed within those time scales. Is that it?
Yeah, sure, and then we'll park in the corner side and ask questions about other parts. On part six, on page 6 of the report, follow-up audit to do with data loss prevention. I looked this up, the deficit inquiries on the original audit was in February 2014, and that was reported to us in September, the 17th of September. The follow-up in that report was actually down as August 2014. So the follow-up should have taken place in August 2014, but in fact took place, it seems, in October. So that's the first question, if you like. If a follow-up audit was agreed, presumably, it was agreed between clients and audit that, you know, we'd be able to put in place the recommendation by the state, etc. So I'm not sure where the slippage has been, whether it's been capacity in audit or whether it's been because recommendations haven't been put in place. It was brought to the attention that it was a minimum control environment with major impact, which is the only one on the pages that we're looking at that seems to have that high risk status. So one would have thought that if a follow-up was planned for a certain days, it wouldn't be allowed to slip much further. So I'd be interested in the reasons for the slippage. In terms of the three recommendations, I'm not clear how far we are down the road, if you like, 12 months on, in implementing the recommendations, and whether we still have a minimum control environment so far as data loss prevention is concerned. Certainly I have received representations from people who do feel there has been data loss, you know, within the council that's affected them either as employees or as people who have taken for a freedom of information request, possibly received too much information. So where are, I know there's no compliance testing taking place, but where are we with compliance, do we feel? How many staff grievances, complaints, information commission investigations are there around allegations or actual instances of data loss within the council?
If I could sort of try and way through the various points you've raised at council. The piece of work was undertaken, as you quite say, back in February 11. The intention was at that time to undertake a follow-up date was agreed with the clients. The reason that follow-up date then subsequently slipped was there has been a significant period of transformation within that particular unit. There's been a lot of quite a high sort of turnaround of staff and their own exhausting issues there. So when we went back to sort of talk to the managers that was with regards to the follow-up audit, it became apparent to me that there was no point whatsoever in actually sort of undertaking that piece of work at that time. There had been significant progress made. However, what had happened in June was that the Information Governance Board had come to prominence. Joe chairs the street director, chairs the sort of the governance board, and they'd taken on board issues in relation to data loss, and the production of data loss policies, and the raising of awareness across the organisation through various training and sort of awareness sessions. The Information Governance Board sort of has grown and developed. I sit on that board as do sort of representatives from across all the various departments in the organisation. And there's a great deal of work that's sort of coming underway to tighten up data, procedures, policies. So it was felt that under those kind of circumstances, pushing the data the whole back to, as you say, to where we are now was not unreasonable. So we continue to sort of keep an eye on that, like we continue to have an input to that process through the Information Governance Board and through bringing the concept that we're having with the new head of that service on the limited new capacity to allow them to address some of the issues. So all I can do is just show that continue to report back to yourselves on with regards this particular issue. It will remain on this report until as the issues have either been addressed something, or I feel that the promise have been raised sufficiently to warrant me coming along to you and saying, I think now is the time for you to invite the relevant sort of senior manager along and ask him questions regarding sort of why these actions are happening. And I don't think we're in a position where we've quite reached that point yet. However, you're quite right to point out that there has been some slippage. In terms of the general culture regarding how we secure and maintain our sort of information, our data. I think over the last, I mean, this again was an issue that was flagged up in the annual government statements previously, of concern for this organisation. There have been significant improvements made, there's no doubt about that. The Information Governance Board has, as I quite happy to say, sort of taken the lead for this. A lot of internal reports have sort of made reference to how information is sort of maintained and secured in various systems across the organisation. They're all being sort of, they're all being included in a specific detailed action plan that the Information Governance Board designed over the implementation of. I'm confident that certainly things have improved. There's more work in front of getting going, but I'm confident that things are moving in the right direction, and that the board, with Joe sharing it and with his direct access to these senior leadership teams, it's on their radar and it's something that they're paying very close attention to. Does that answer?
Just to follow up, in your second follow-up, is you spoke out for March 15. Top of heaven and over the next meeting, presumably.
It is in March,
so it's about a week.
That's
it. Well, we have no particular figures so that we can gauge, if you like, whether there is a problem with data loss, how much data, there's private data, has been lost or released.
We certainly will have access to data relating to where we have lost data, yes. It's held within, if I'm not mistaken, the remote services or something. So certainly some of the colleagues there and bring something back to the March meeting that provides them with some sort of context for within which this sits and an update with regards to where this particular issue is at.
So in terms of the context for this, I think the starting point of the four questions that I had in my head at the original start of this, have there been any impropriety in terms of the commissioning of this organisation? Had the organisation delivered to expectations? Had the company at any point misled us and therefore needed to for any clawback of any funds? And had there been any errors in the approach to engaging with them? And I guess the answer to the first three questions is no, that there's no impropriety, that the company had delivered to expectations, that had no point to the company misled us, and therefore there's no need for clawback. However, as Mark's quite rightly pointed out, there had been some errors, certainly in terms of the approach to engaging with this company, and I'll expand on that more now, if it makes sense. So the backdrop to this is that back in August of last year, in the absence of the Director of Resources, Chief Executive was asked to sign what's called an E111 form, which is designed to be a business case for those contracts that have been exceeding a 10% threshold, which is what we've agreed as being a reasonable contract extension threshold for office of delegation. This was forwarded to the Chief Exec and he was concerned to check out the validity of this particular expenditure. In terms of that, he approached the strategic director responsible in this particular case in terms of families and wellbeing in relation to being a leisure and DAS related service area in order for the chief exec to be convinced and alerted to any reasons as to why payments would be made and also to gain appropriate assurances. In terms of that, the relevant portfolio holder was involved in additional commissioning arrangements under the delegated authority. And following the tendering process, she was alerted as soon as it became apparent that this threshold had been breached and then kept informed throughout the process. So the chief executive would remain concerned and asked me, well, nice, have a chat with Mark and the team about earlier discussions about this as an issue. We were concerned enough to actually formally undertake a review payments through to B4, as Mark said, and covering what was commissioned by the council officers, what was actually spent, and what officers had actually followed the council's relevant rules. So the initial commissioning and subsequent tendering for the transmission of leisure services was undertaken correctly, but senior managers did not comply with elements of the council's contract procedure rules in that expenditure under the contract had exceeded the 10% threshold, and this is clearly in breach of CPRs and needs to be reported here this evening. The context of that is the approved expenditure was £97,500, but actual spend was £117,928, which is effectively 11% above the CPR threshold, or around £10,000. In terms of further reporting on it, it was also incorrectly believed that a continuation of this previously procured services from the company through a national procurement framework for a separate programme of work could also be applied in relation to a business case for the development of a local authority trading company for social services, day services. Mark's already reported in his report on the appendix site here, there's no influence of impropriety on behalf of any council officer. It's crucial that the council's rules are fully complied with to ensure legality, demonstrate transparency, and also to protect reputation. The audit identified that management controls have not been as robust as they could have been or should have been. This included a lack of formal orders or contracts for the additional programme of work. Moreover, commissioning a review and challenge report by the company who performed the work being subject to that review has been accepted as the incorrect process to follow, and a review by a wholly independent body is in the process of being commissioned. It's quite clear that breaches of the contract procedure rules detailed in the report must be reported. The conclusions of these were that the total gross payments to V4 Limited were £193,620 in relation to leisure services, and £91,912 in relation to DAS services. So an overall total, which had been reported previously in the press, of £285,532. It is the opinion of the relevant service areas involved that the company has enabled the leisure services to reduce its costs, and in relation to DAS, have helped realise the savings required, as well as providing the necessary knowledge to design the implementation plan for the local authority trading company. The Chief Director for Families and Wellbeing is satisfied with the results and the conclusions of their work. Therefore, there is no suggestion of any need for any clawback of any funds from them. However, there have been breaches of the Council's contract procedure rules in the awarding and the monitoring of the work we've done. I would reiterate there is no inference of impropriety against any Council officer, but there have been examples of poor control and these need to be corrected. We must consider corporately that the potential lack of independence over the last strategic business case and the challenge reports have indicated that this has already been taken up and there will be an independent review of that. And the outcomes of this audit actually reinforced the need for us to give serious priority to the centralisation of payments processes, and this is being taken forward through the development of the transaction centre as part of the remodeling framework. We must ensure that appropriate training is initiated for senior managers. That has already been undertaken in Families and Wellbeing and is being extended right across the organisation and will be completed by March. In terms of the emphasis of the culture, is always to ensure that our procurement section and our legal team, prior to any new or amended procurement activity takes place. And finally, just to say, Chair, that in terms of what is in final paragraph of what Mark said, all 11 recommendations have been made and they've all been accepted and agreed for progress to be implemented. Formal progress against the action plan will be monitored by the internal governance group that Mark referred to, and that in turn reports to the portfolio of the corporate governance. Internal audit will also continue to monitor this, and I'm sure that they will bring back to Audit Risk Management Committee an update in future in the usual way. Finally, we know that the contract procedure rules are currently under review, and that's to ensure that they comply with the draft public contract regulations in 2015, that are anticipated to be laid before Parliament on or before the 30th of March of this year. And officers in procurement and legal services will take the opportunity to review, to improve and to clarify procedures and practices to help ensure all reasonable steps are taken to mitigate any such occurrence. And members, of course, Chair, will have the opportunity to review the revised CPRs before they're recommended to Council.
Any questions?
If there have been breaches of council regulations, somebody's breached them. So why have officers been found not to have breached rules when it clearly stated that they have been breached?
Officers have breached the rules. I think what I said, there's no clarity as a consequence of those breach. And what was required was a formal reminder of the processes that we had in terms of contract procedures, and also formal training for those members of staff, which has taken place. And I said that we've also ensured that right across the organisation, staff, world managers will be reminded of their responsibilities, accountability, within the subcontract procedure rules, so they have been held to account for the breach of the procedures.
So Councillor Martin says that the breach of procedures have been held to account, but that wasn't clear in what you said originally. You said that there was no blame.
I'm sorry, I think what I said was there's no impropriety. I said clearly that being a breach of those officers have been spoken with, and training has taken place on the procurement team have been, I think I did say they've been already to the service area of concern, families and well-being. They will extend that training across the whole organisation to remind us all of our responsibilities.
Stuart?
I was trying to follow the figures of you, but sorry. I might not be overly mouthful, but the first set of figures was the original contract was for 97k. And then rose to 117k, which is I thought is what triggered this greater than 10% threshold. Well, I get the difference between 97 and 117 is 20%, rather than the 11 that we said. So I might be thinking of the long. I might be comparing one set of figures. That's probably not well. What I'm not entirely sure about is. Is well, no one would come to decide or think, I know, what we need to do here is extend this contract because that saves, retendering or effectively, thinking about what it is that we want to get rather than gossip. Is there a danger sometimes these consultants say, I can do this for you, if you give me another 12 months? So I'm concerned, where is it led? Is it led by us or is it led by the consultants? Effectively say, give us another 12 months, we'll do a little bit more for it, don't worry about it. We can do this, we can do that. Or is it us saying, actually, while we've got the bed in the hand, that's easier, maybe cheaper, etc. So that's the first concern. Second concern is we see a lot of it, but it probably might just be that we see them because it is outside the contract procedures. We see a lot of extensions of contracts for 1 year. 2 years potentially. And I see the reports that we've got have a more detailed report certainly around the social services one, but not around the V4 one, which I think might have been usually in its own right. I'm just wondering whether we keep any sort of central database of this. Here's a contract. We decided to extend it. Why have we decided to extend it? Because there might be an argument saying, oh, we're doing it because it's easy. Is it too easy? Clearly it isn't too easy, because we seem to have got to a situation where we've extended it, the rules haven't been followed. So I don't know how complicated the rules are, or what people have got to do if they want to extend this contract. But I'm just wondering whether we can try and get a little bit more of a handle on the extent of extensions within the council, and whether really it compares with other authorities. Whether we're doing it because it's the right thing to do, or we're doing it because actually, the contractor, there's consultants, or there's coming back to us and saying, give us another 12 months. I'm not I'm not sure, you know, where we sit with extensions as a general, as a general rule, as opposed to planning ahead. I understand the arguments about each structure, etc. And say, okay, this protest got 12 months too long. Let's think about it now, you know, because too often I think we see in reports, a contract is extended because we haven't had the wherewithal to begin to plan for the re-tendering. And if we get into extensions, then there is that danger there. The final thing I don't fully follow about the V4 thing is, did the extension have an end date? Because it strikes me that if you're going to extend it for to do new work, then it is almost a new tender, because surely we're asking, well, how much are you going to charge and when's it going to finish? So I'm still not sure where we are with V4, possibly because the date has not been in for. And I'm not sure entirely where we are with contracts, extensions, and the management oversight things.
Okay. Thanks very much. I'll stick to the V4 questions first, and I'll come on to the more general. In terms of the figures, you're absolutely right. It's 21%, and the 11% I referred to has been 11% above the 10% threshold.
Of course.
But yes, it's 21% in terms of the statistic. In terms of the end date of the extension, I mean, clearly that is one of the issues that I think Mark's seen picked up, is that it hadn't been tight enough, and that's clearly the lesson learned that we've gone back to the service area to all our managers to remind them of their responsibilities about that. And I think that ties in a little bit with the generalities that you referred to in terms of some of the contract extensions. I think first of all, in terms of the central database, yes, we all want. We do have all the contracts available, quite a lot of them, as you can imagine. Covering all sorts of different things as well. Sometimes it looks as though we've got quite a wide-ranging number of contracts with similar organisations, but we're all tendered for or contracted for. And what we do, certainly now, more comprehensively, is as part of the procurement and commissioning framework, we're actually trying to tie those together so that we are commissioning and procuring at the same time, so that when we're out of sync in terms of this is a 3-year contract, maybe enter into another 3-year contract with the same organisation, so that's an overlap of a year. We're trying to extend that for another year, then you can go up again for tender with a whole amount of money, if that makes sense. So we're trying to get tighter in terms of making sure that we can tender for our services in a much more planned way. And you're absolutely right in terms of getting those plans together. In terms of EU contracts, OG contracts, they roughly take about 9 months to commission overall. So we are thinking 9 to 12 months ahead in terms of those contracts renewals and support. We get that cycle absolutely correct. And there are genuine reasons for extensions. And I think what this has exercised is to ensure that managers do remember there are reasons for extensions, and we make those explicit as to why it's okay for an extension. And the first point is there an option to extend within the original contract specification? And if there is an option to exist, if there isn't, then the question is why would we extend that contract? In terms of those number of extensions, I'm sure we could at some future meetings share with relevant details of the numbers, etc., if that would help. And I think the final question was around, is it led by us or led by consultants? And I think absolutely it's led by us. And this is a timely reminder to ensure that it is led by us in terms of those arrangements. There's no suggestion here in terms of the audit findings that gives any cause for concern that this has been a situation that has been led by an outside agency. But it's a timely reminder about who does have the group on it. It's absolutely us. We need to make sure that all managers recognise their responsibility and accountability for that.
Any more questions? Thanks for that, Joe, and thanks for your report, Mark. Can we read the recommendation?
Read.
Item 4.
Thanks, Chair. Evening, everybody. Robin Baker from Grant Thornton. Delighted to meet you all. I'm the new engagement lead responsible for the audit. I think this is a tick over from Mike Thomas, Before I know the person, say one or two things, just following the instruction, if I may, Chair. So, first of all, obviously, the key thing I'm trying to do is make sure that there was a smooth and appropriate handover to myself and Mike. So, I'll back with Mike and Chris, and they've given me a full briefing in terms of where you are and the developments, so that's good. So, I'll enter with a proper handover process. I'm also the auditor for World Technical Commissioning Group and a number of the other councils locally, including Cheshire West and Liverpool. I sit on Grand Thornton's local government board as well, so I do quite a bit of work on some local government reports looking at trying to drive improvement in local government. Look forward to working with you and getting to know you over the next couple of years. I think my view is that, you know, clearly our role is to be a constructive friend, a constructive challenge to what you're doing, and that obviously involves working with you effectively. So that's what I wanted to say, just very briefly. Look forward to getting to know you. I'll just hand over to Chris just in terms of our briefing report. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Robin. Thank you, Chair. If I can just take you through the audit committee update report we provide to you. This is seeking to set out the progress that we intend to make and have made against our key audit programme for the 2014-15 audit year, and also seeks to summarise key issues and developments, including Grant Thornton National Report that may be of interest to you. It references key accounting and audit issues and changes. It also seeks to identify any local government advice and issues that are relevant to local government. I can refer you to page 27 of our report. That is the tables there set out the key elements of our audit programme, as I mentioned. The left-hand column shows that we undertake an interim accounts audit. That commenced just prior to Christmas. We continue to see the offices and those continue post-Christmas and into February. We have begun our interim visit, which involves, as the document sets out, understanding documentation of the key systems. We liaise with a leader of internal audit, amongst other things, and that work culminates in the production of our 2014-15 audit plan. And we set out in the right-hand column that we intend to bring that to you, presented at the audit committee of the 18th of March 2015. Two further elements that we set out are our final accounts audit that we have undertaken in July to September, and also the value for money conclusion work that runs concurrently with that, culminating in the production of our audit findings report and finally with the annual audit letter. We intend to say way too more than that. As mentioned, on pages 29 to 36 are the articles that I mentioned. We seek to provide hyperlinks where appropriate to electronic versions of those documents, but I would be happy to provide a hard copy should members or anybody wish. And that's all I intended to say. Thank you. I will take any questions should we have any.
Thanks, Chris. Any questions? Okay. Thank you very much for that report. Item 5,
Mike. Thanks, Chair. In terms of budget for 2015-16, our approach to risk financing is obviously key element of our overall approach to risk management. The report sets out our expectations of costs in the year ahead and how it will impact both the general fund and the schools. Headline is a very small increase in the overall budget. There's obviously a change between the schools and general fund, which I'll talk about in a little more detail later. Set us through on to Sam really just talk about our overall approach to risk financing. It's a repeat of what we were taking to previously. A couple of points I would like to make in relation to section 2.9 on page 38. We talked to when I came last time about the discussion we were having with the proposed liability insurance about the new terms for 2015-16. The market for liability risk for local government has been very bad for quite some time. We originally faced an increase of about 40% through negotiation with them. That has come down to 14%. Our opinion is that is in the current market probably the best terms that we are likely to get and couldn't be improved on with a procurement exercise at this time, and therefore we ask for your sanction and got it to proceed on that basis. issues is that we have been able to moderate that increase in the external premium when we pay to the outside insurer by a modest reduction in our self-insured premium. So overall costs for next year will actually be slightly less on the the other two major classes of business, which is material damage and motor, it broadly stayed. No real change in our expectations around cover or into these avenues. I could draw your attention to section 212, which talks about the overall costs of the new service itself. Again, the overall headline is a very small drop in the overall costs of running the service next year. And section 2.45 really talks about the overall budget itself, the change between 1415 and 1516, and how that is affecting both schools and the general fund. It looks as if, on the face of it, that schools are facing a really heavy rise. What I try to bring out in paragraph 216 is that the overall figure is significantly more. That's because 1516 includes three schools, including two major high schools, who didn't actually feature in the 1415 figures because we thought they would be handled by this point. So we had to build them back. Overall, schools are facing an increase of about 7%. We have done some benchmarking in the past. We continue to keep our eye on the market, and we are confident that even with the changes, schools are getting much better view from the authority than they would get from the commercial insurance market. Generally, schools seem to be realising that and seeking those for their services. There are some relevant risks in the on page. They're very similar to what we were told you about last time when we called the insurance budget for 2014-15. One point I would say on 3.5 on page 42, we are starting to see some benefits, some small benefit from the changes to the civil justice system, particularly around the amount of money they're allowing to pay to private parties and solicitors on rare occasions when they actually have a successful case against us. The changes are finally starting to actually bring those costs down, which is very pleasing to see, not just for us, but for the authorities. And we're hopeful that going forward, we may even be able to sort of reduce the contributions to the insurance fund in the firm. But it's still relatively low debt. That was all I was going to say, but I'm happy to take any questions.
Sorry, any questions?
Just on the last point you made, have you got any sort of figures on the reduction to the council spend since the change to the...
We've got some individual cases which have been brought to my attention by colleagues, I can bring some more detailed information back, but just as an example, we had one recently where we had to settle a case, and the figures that we ended up paying were around £7,000 or £8,000. When previously with the old regime, it would possibly have been 10 times that amount of money. That's quite a stark example, but there are others, and I'd be happy to actually bring back some more detailed information to show you how things are actually panning out in practice, if that would be helpful.
Interesting.
Thank you.
Chair, I just wanted to, there's obviously a lot of work.